So let's get started with the talk. A little bit about me. First of all, let's start with praying that everyone's loved ones are staying safe and healthy. So, who am I? I'm a master's student majoring in data science at UMass Amherst, and I've been in the industry for almost 3 years working as a developer. My recent courseworks have introduced me to NLP, and I have been loving exploring this field for quite a while now. And I hope you like it too, and I'm able to spark something there in you, if not already. So the agenda for today's session is to discuss the emergence of NLP for finance. In this session, we will discuss how the NLP evolved from how it was interpreted decades ago to how it is considered now. Specifically, we will focus on how the changes in NLP were visible in the financial domain. Let's start from basics. What is NLP, or should I say natural language processing? So, natural language processing is a subfield in artificial intelligence which deals with processing of natural language, be it text or speech. The text can be news, article, book, journal, or even a tweet. Any form of communication which comes under natural language also comes under NLP. So why should we be concerned about NLP for finance? Let's try to understand this with few examples. On May 1st, Mark Zuckerberg, the CEO of Facebook, said that he wants Facebook to be a place where new relationships start. You know what was the impact of this statement? The shares of companies belonging to the Match Group, like Tinder, Bumble, their shares plunged. Can anyone guess why? The shares of the companies like Tinder, Bumble plunged because, as if Facebook steps into this area, it will be a big competitor for them. And therefore, people did not want to invest in this. They want to de-invest. And therefore, the shares plunged. For the more recent example, so this was the statement. This was the news in New York Times. Stocks surged as central banks vowed to act on coronavirus. This happened because the investors were now feeling kind of safe because now the government is involved and their money will not be lost somewhere. So I think we have enough motivation to start with this. These examples show the importance of text in the finance domain. There were no numbers involved in the statements, yet completely unrelated entities were impacted due to this. There have been two major theories in finance which are still being talked about. First, which is Deakin's first theory, is random walk theory, which dates back to 1964. According to random walk theory, the path that stock follows is completely random and it is not possible to predict the stock prices. So according to this theory, this stock is useless and we should not even talk about financial modeling. Yet we are doing so. There is something we need to find out. On the other hand, another well-known theory, efficient market hypothesis, says that the stock always reflects what is going on with the company. It's never underpriced, never overpriced. The current prices of the stock reflect all the publicly information available, and its movement is to incorporate the new public information. And it also says that the stock quickly adapts to whatever information is available and it leaving almost no room for prediction. So according to this, it is not possible to do predictions again. So one major thing we can see that this even these theories were present, the research community still went ahead and started exploring new methods, and most of the attempts have been successful in doing this. One major thing I want to highlight before starting this process is in this talk, we are covering the major trends in the NLP for finance. So around the same time this theory came, a new model was also introduced, ATRANS, short for Automatic Fund Transfer Telex Reader. It was proposed to be real-world natural understanding system. And the work of this model was just to extract sender and receiver bank information from telex messages. Let me tell you, these messages were one sentence long at max. And this model was made for a very restricted domain of international bank transfer. But so What are the interesting things about this old model, which we are still discussing now? Researchers back then also faced issues with ambiguous words, and they handled it by maintaining the scope. For example, if I enter into a scope of date during the reading telex messages, I will encounter whatever number I will encounter is date, not amount. Very impressive, right? But today also we use almost the same concept, but a more advanced strategy. So any guesses how this model could have been implemented? Yes, no, for rule-based models? Yes, it was rule-based models. And this was also one of the most common problems with these type of models. For every unseen case, a new rule was required, taking down the robustness of the model for a toss. Also, was this model even understanding the text or just extracting? It was just extracting, right? Not understanding as it claimed to be in today's world. Then comes the era of neural networks, not the present era, but the neural networks which were trained using sigmoid nonlinearity. Because the neural networks were able to model complex relationships without much of the feature engineering, it quickly gained the interest of the research community. But to this time, not many methods were available to efficiently represent text into numbers. And also compute was very expensive during that time. Therefore, people started using historical data with neural networks. One such work was modeling stocks for TOPIX. TOPIX is Tokyo Stock Exchange Price Index. This model used various types of historical data like price index, foreign currency exchange rate, and many other things. This model simulation gave very good returns. Simultaneously, the work with the text also started to become more concrete. People realized the importance of news in the financial domain. They knew that it was important, but they understood that it is very hard for humans to track all the news channels and streams so that they can take informed decision. Thus, they made models which could summarize the news into well-defined templates. A good thing about this work was that the authors claimed that if the news articles were not able to fit into any template, then that article is not important for stock movement prediction. With these works, we can imagine the models that have started to become more complex as compared to simple rule-based models. From one sentence, the work moved to a complete news article. But still, these templates thus formed were used by human analysts, which still leaves room for improvement. After the neural networks started to face the problem of exploding and vanishing gradients, the research focus shifted towards SVMs. During this time, a lot of interesting and innovative works were published. These were attempts which used just text to predict stock movement. A well-known paper, Lazy Prices, was also published during the same time, which also did not use SVM, but this paper is considered so important that still in many studies, this paper has been referred. This work was done by a group at Harvard, and they proposed that even a change in the wordings or the pattern of the filings of the company is an indicator of the change in office stock. So quick overview, filings are the yearly or annual filings which the company, publicly traded companies, file with the government, and they provide a lot of details about the company, like how it performed and various risk and the discussion and the future which they see. So they propose that even if you are changing the pattern in which how these sections are arranged, it is an indicator of how the stock may perform in future. Then there was another work which analyzed the effect of news articles on stocks after 20 minutes of release. How they came up with this figure? They tested their models for different time frames, and they got best accuracy for 20 minutes time frame. This model also debased efficient market hypothesis, which said that it is not possible to predict in a particular time frame. It quickly adapts. Another interesting model, which was AZ FinTech system, they made different models with different combinations of data to analyze the importance of historical data and news with different text representation schemes. So for example, they made various models in which the input was just tech, another model in which input was just historical data, another model in which the input was both historical and regressed text and regressed stock historical data, and many more. So after this, during this, as we can see, a lot of corpora has been explored. And for the models in which the models, according to AZ FinTech system, a model which combines both text and the historical data, not the regressed data, gives the best, gives better results. And they also tried with different kinds of text representation schemes. But for them, named entity recognition gave better results. So as we can see, now we are moving toward a bigger corpora as compared to one system, to a news articles, to a SEC filing, which is around 50 to 60 pages long. And the models are becoming quite complex to understand. We have multiple text representation schemes, and we have schemes so that we can compare. And even compute was becoming more available to research community. After this, the era of deep learning came, the present era. We have done so much success in this field, from perceptron to recurrent neural network to convolution neural network to transformers. Neural networks have shown great advancements in the last decade. One such work used a particular section from SEC filings, risk factor section. Risk factor section is a section in which the company details about all the risks which the company assess could be possible for the company in the near future or in long term. They using this section, there has been work which shows that they can easily predict whether the bank will fail or not. They used CNN for modeling this. And in this work, they have not only used just exact corpora, but they are also comparing the text which is there in the filings from previous year. They take different texts, so we can see that even the focus is not just on the quantity but the quality also of the corpora. This era saw growth in both generative and discriminative models. On the generative side, StockNet came into picture, which used latent variables to predict stock prices using Twitter and stock prices. This is a very well-known paper which I said on the discriminative, on the generative side, and explaining it is out of scope of this talk. So I would direct the users to have a look at this paper also. On the discriminative side, BERT disrupted the whole landscape. I'm hoping that most of the people who are enthusiastic about NLP must be aware about BERT. This is a model which has been published by Google in 2019. And since then, it is everywhere. It is used in every NLP task possible. Why it has been used? Because it is generalizable. You can just training it once can be used it for various different tasks. So a model FinBERT came, which was trained on SEC filings. So the BERT model now was also part of the financial domain. The group which published FinBERT also analyzed the financial language change over the period of 20 decades using the embeddings of the words. Quick check, what is embeddings? Embeddings are some kind of numerical representation of text, which is taken from a hidden layer of the models, neural networks model, and mostly it is the last hidden layer of which we consider as a text representation. They observed that cloud, when they analyzed the financial language over the period of 20 decades, they found that the word cloud, which was earlier around the Hydra related industries, it has currently moved towards software related industry. We are in this era, and many great models are still coming in, which can potentially outdate BERT also very quickly. seriously, very quickly. But what are the problems with this? Don't you think in the time frame which we have come here, we have made our models more complex, more robust? It can learn a lot of things. It can do a lot of things. But are these models explainable? No. And this is the main reason why even the advancement in NLP related models, the acceptability is not there in the finance domain, because they don't want to invest in black boxes. And what they are doing, what the models are doing, what they are learning, we don't know. So in the fintech system, in the financial market, even when machine learning is used, the people mostly prefer decision trees, because these are rule-based models. They are interpretable. They can visualize it. They can see what model is doing. Nonetheless, with the deep learning, great new avenues are also opened up, like for the embeddings, word embeddings versus sentence embeddings. Whether should I represent the whole sentence using a specific word-related embedding or the whole sentence representation? Should I go with transformers or convolution neural network? Should I take a combination of both? Should I take self-attention layer? There's a different varieties and different combination possible, and everyone is working through it. With this, I think we are at the end of my session. You can ask the question now, or you can email me later at my email ID. And if anyone wants, they can also ask for the slides on the same email ID. And now let's get back to questions. Anyone have any question? So Ronak has asked question, where is NLP in finance headed to now, and what do you think is next in this domain? Well, NLP in finance is now working towards more specified domain, not just finance in not in like finance particular, but they are getting things specific to a company or specific to an industry, like just software industry, just pharma industry, because it is tough for the models to generalize. So there are models like BioBERT or CyBERT, which are trained on just medical text. So they are making everything domain specific. Moreover, still there are a lot of attempts in combining both textual sources and financial sources. And there's also another question, what project you are currently working on. So recently I worked on a project. I think I can answer more of Ronak's question using answering this question also. So currently I worked on a project in which we were going through SEC filings, and in which we had to predict the stock fundamentals. So why we were going for stock fundamentals, not stocks, because they follow random pattern. Could you predict that the crisis was about to come, like with the statement I shared earlier that government is investing, government has vowed to invest, so the stocks increase? It was not possible to predict using just historical data. I worked on combining both the stock fundamentals values, historical stock fundamental values, and stock text. And we just took only two sections from our work took only two sections from the SEC filings, risk factors and management discussions. And we saw that, I would like to share that, we saw that the best representation for text is financial sentiment analysis, the sentiment score which you can give to the text. And definitely comparing the difference is an important thing. So there's another question. Can we get your slide and recording missed in first half? Well, I am not aware about when will I get the recording, but whenever I'll get, I'll definitely share it. And for the slides, you can mail me at my email ID. I'm typing it in the chat box. If anyone has any question or they think that I have not answered the question properly, please go ahead. So there are questions, which other sectors do you think NLP can be useful in future? Well, seeing the current future, we are in pandemic. There is one more. So we can see a movement towards healthcare industry of NLP. There have been a recent data set has been released called 19, which just consists of papers related to coronavirus in general. And people have been in the research community, people have been working to it to get the important information from that, because it is not possible in this little time frame for even the researchers in the healthcare industry to get important information. Therefore, they are making NLP models. Even I worked on an NLP model in which we can pull out important documents from that. So given you you give a question, so we pull out important documents in which those question related answers can be found. It is a very open and vague domain, but it will be more generalized later. Would that be unsupervised learning? Training the models is always unsupervised, because it is very tough to find a data set which has been labeled. So the usual practice which is being taken care of right now is people pre-train the model, like FinBERT. It is pre-trained on the SEC filings, which is done completely unsupervised. But when you fine-tune it for a task like sentiment analysis, you take a small data set and then you fine-tune it to give sentiment score. So that's how the trend has been done. So because the models like BERT and all are very huge and they need a lot of corpus, so it has been trained unsupervisedly and then fine-tuned in supervised manner. For sentiment analysis, how much text do you need to identify the sentiment? It is not dependent on the length of the text, I would say. It is very much dependent on the model you are saying. I am very much aware about the BERT. So the BERT has a limitation that it can take 500 tokens at a time. So even if you give less than that, it will work. If not, then also it will work. It just needs to be fine-tuned on that. Even people have done a sentiment analysis for just a tweet, which has a limited number of characters in it. There is another question. Do you think sentiment analysis is a solved problem, or can it still be improved? There is always room for improvement in all these models, because if we know it or not, if the model has seen the words, it has seen how to classify that word, it will give sentiment analysis. But there could be word which, you know, we come up with new words every day. And if there are words which the model has not seen, there are very less chances that it will perform well. So there is always room for improvement. In fact, right now, the industry, the research community in NLP particularly, are working towards more generalizable, if anyone is aware of transfer learning. So training on one data, training for one task and then using it for another task. Okay, any other question? Thanks for the appreciation, people.